Just a couple of announcements. One is, what happened? Couple announcements. One is that we've been in contact with public health, and they have said we can lighten up on a couple things. So one is, you'll be able to sing. You have to leave your mask on, but you can sing, and we'll have lyrics for you. So if you want to sing along, you can do that. And then secondly, we can also take communion where you're sitting. You just have to kind of lift your mask and do it like this. So if you don't know about how the communion works, we have communion packets for you back there. You take off the top of your wafer, and your wine is there. So when it comes to the appropriate time, you can take it here. So you don't have to take it when you walk out. Now, that should get a round of applause right there. Because that's yay! A couple of weeks, we'll have the last indoor service on the 19th. We'll have seniors here receiving their quilts and have kind of a wrap-up. And then, for the summer, the first and the third Wednesdays, 6 o'clock, same time, out in the parking lot, we will have worship. So when it's a beautiful day like it is today, we can be outside. I think those are all of our announcements. Let us pause for a moment, prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Let us begin our worship on this Cinco de Mayo in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
And if you can covenly share the peace with each other, look, wave, say hi.
Great.
Please join me in our call to worship. Follow along. In the bold-faced prayer. There it is. Okay, you ready? Come join the journey of the Christ today.
We have come to join the journey of Christ today.
Come walk with the one who abides with us.
We will live in an abiding relationship with Christ.
Come join the journey of Christ today. Let's sing.
Time to give your heart. Come.
And we come before our Lord for worship. A reminder that Christ died for us on the cross. And so we come just the way we were created. And we confess that he is our Lord. For our confession of sin, I invite you to join along with me as well as we all together confess our sin. Gracious God, let us bring our failures, weaknesses, and sins before the Lord.
I lay down my sins and my burdens before you, O Lord.
We have all sinned against God and against our neighbors.
Forgive us our trespasses.
Forgive us and create clean hearts within us, O Lord.
Restore to me a clean heart, O Lord.
Bring your mercy and cleanse our hearts, O Lord. Forgiven and loved child of God.
I am accepted, forgiven, and loved child of God.
I am. Accepted.
Forgiven and loved of God.
I am. Accepted.
Forgiven and loved child of God.
Very good. We have a prayer of the day that I invite you to pray with me. Let us pray. Gracious Lord God, through you
our lives have been restored into a new relationship with God.
Help us to abide in you and you in us.
May we trust your promise to hear our prayer.
We pray in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord,
who lives and reigns with you, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our reading for this evening comes from 1 John, which is different from the Gospel of John. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out all fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, I love God, and hate their brother or sister are liars. For those who do not love a brother or a sister whom they have seen cannot love God who they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and their sisters also. The word of God.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is a lamb.
COVID has done this to everyone at the same time. Very rarely in my lifetime I've never seen that. There are signs of it, 9/11, after a war, depression. Those things bring people to the surface. And there's this rawness that they feel. Now when you feel that, this is when people start to ask questions. And they start to think about things like faith and God and what is it. Now when the world looks at us, they see us as this church over here, metaphorically on a hill. But a lot of people do not understand or know the God that we do. And they're looking. I tell you what, they're looking. And I talk to them and they'll talk about how they believe in auras and colors and vibrations and all these different things. But nobody's told them about our God. And specifically, Jesus Christ. Now, one of Jesus' tasks in life was to explain the unexplainable. The Bible says over and over, you cannot see God face to face. You can only see a glimpse or a shadow. But Jesus is trying to explain the unexplainable to people. And that's what he does today. It is our opportunity at this moment in time when people are raw and they're vulnerable and they're asking questions, tell them about what Christ told us. And so today is one of those times. But the issue is, now you're all going, oh, I have to go up to somebody and tell them about Jesus. It's hard to do. Where do we begin? How do we show it? How do we explain people our faith when they've never encountered it before? California, by the way, Scotch County. I mean, that's like the lowest percent of people who are Christian members, isn't it? Some counties are like 0. Blah, blah, blah.
It used to be that way.
Did it?
It used to be a hot spot.
Really? So how do you explain the unexplainable? So I have relatives in India. They've had COVID. They've got it over now. But I have this Aunt Rosie, and she's about 4'10 or something like this. Kind of an angry little Indian. But she loves us. And she would come and visit us as the boys were growing up. And I remember a particular time when she came to see our middle son, Sam, play football. Okay? And it was a late September, October night. I can't remember what town it was in, but we had to bundle up. And so we went to this game, and we're all bundled up, and especially her, when she's from India, and they got lots of extra clothes on because, you know, they're not used to the cold. And we get there, and I said, I'll explain this football game to you. And she was looking really funny out there, and she said, I thought we were going to a football game. And it's American football. If you're from any other place in the world, football is soccer, right? So she thought we were going to soccer. So we get there, and she has never seen football before, never in her life. And so I'm trying to explain to her football, right? Okay, and she asked me, but why is the ball that shape? Why is it leather? Does that come from a pig? All these things. And I'm like, no. So you can imagine how difficult that is. And I think we feel that same way. We take all this for granted. Let the pastor do it. But how are people going to understand the God that we know? Why can't we share what that is? Well, I tell you, it's difficult. It's like trying to explain football to my mom. But that's what Jesus does. Jesus comes and takes the most common element, the thing that everybody has or everybody knows, so that when he makes an analogy, people will get it. And so in his day and time, it was an agrarian society. Everybody grew their own food. Okay? We don't live in that world anymore. Everybody knew how to garden, how to farm. I've been in the city and talked to people that have never held dirt. You know, we're so far away from, how do we take this gospel and explain it like Jesus did? Well, I'm not a very good gardener. I admit, we have a garden, but I leave it up to the rest of the family. I think everybody can kind of get this, right? You heard the gospel, there's a vine grower, there's a farmer or a gardener, and then there's the vine. And Jesus says, I am the vine. And then Jesus says, you are the branches. And those three together, Jesus calls it abiding, those three together produce fruit. I was trying to think of, if we were to tell that story in the same gist that Jesus did, like take a common thing that we all have and we would all understand worldwide, what would that be? Cell phone, internet, something like that. I don't know. But that's what he does. And maybe we can rethink that too. What is God like? So I'm going to show you three elements that are in this gospel today, where Jesus is explaining in a unexplainable type of God, a mystery. He says it this way, three things. First thing is, he talks about God as being relational, okay? God is not a color. God is not a vibration. God is not a crystal. God is a being that we can be in relationship to. Throughout God, the Bible, you hear the story about God in relationship to us. Now, that's a big deal, that we have a God that's relational, that sent part of himself to this world to live with us, to abide. That's what it means, to abide with us. And I'll tell you why it's important. So, since we're on the topic of money, my dad was from India and came over and was Hindu when he came here. He went to school in Baltimore. And a few guys invited him to this Bible study they had. And after a couple of years, my dad says, that's when he considered himself a Christian. Now, my mom will argue that, or she used to. She made sure he got baptized Lutheran, so that was her deal. But I said, when it comes down to my dad saying, well, how is it that you decided, because you chose to be a Christian? And he said, it's not about understanding myths and values. It's not about knowing the stories. It's not about, in Hinduism, they do a lot of stuff, yoga, meditation, all those things. He said, with Christianity, it was a person. There's a person of Jesus Christ, a real person of God that lived here, and I have a relationship, and that God has a relationship with me. And that's how we explain God. We have Father, Son, Holy Spirit, which is feminine, by the way. It's a relationship, okay? That's the first one. Now, the second one that's in the text that's in the Bible, I just read the gospel, is pruning, okay? Pruning. Now, how do you explain pruning? Well, it's first, and again, I'm not a gardener, but you can correct me if you are. So why do you prune your plants? Anybody know why you prune?
Keep them
healthier.
To keep them healthier.
Yeah. In that tragedy, your whole life, you have to honor. Think back at your life, and those symbiotic God in communication with each other, all abiding together. So here's my hope, that in your lifetime, I want you to think about the symbiosis that's happened in your life and how it's produced good fruit, because that's the goal. Because you guys have already done that. Think about in your life the good fruit that you've produced in your life. And don't So you all kind of God to the world. And it's just as natural as symbiosis, as a relationship with God is, but it produces good fruit. And that's how people are going to know our God, the God of Jesus Christ. Vine grower, vines, branches. How do you like them apples?
They're like damn apples.
Let us pray. Gracious God, for the relationship that we have with you, that you are a God that abides in us, lives in us, has come down to be with us here on earth, we give you thanks. Help us as you produce good fruit through us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God.
Please join me as we affirm our faith in Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let's join together in our affirmation of faith. We believe in the God of all creation, the Holy One, who created us and all living things. We believe in God's Son, Jesus Christ, Savior of the world. He has promised that he abides in us, and we abide in him, and nothing can separate us from this love of Christ Jesus, for he has saved us through his life, death, and resurrection. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who abides within, through, and around us, leading us to the right paths, serving God and our neighbor. We believe in an abiding God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Once again, I ask you to join me in prayer with bow your heads. Gracious Lord God, we begin our prayer by giving you thanks for all that you've given us. We extend our cries to you during this difficult time that has changed us all. Help us to be strong and take risks to show people who you are. When people ask us what we believe, that we believe in you. We pray, Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Gracious God, we thank you for creation, for all the created order that's around us, for the grass that's turning green, for the trees that are budding, for the birds that are coming back, for a change of season. We give you thanks. Help us as we try to be good stewards and try to take care of the land that you've given us. We pray, Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Gracious God, we bring to you our struggles, our pains, the small deaths that are in our lives, our failures, those things that make us seem like we're not as important or that we're not deserving. We thank you, Lord, for making us accepted, forgiving, forgiven, loved children. When those times come, Lord, help us lift them up to you to see all that you've done for us as children of God. We pray, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Gracious Lord, we pray for those family and friends and people that we know of who are going through a particularly difficult time. For some, that's physical. For others, it's mental. Yet others, emotional and spiritual. We pray especially for Sarah tonight. We pray for Pastor Jessica. She struggles with COVID. And we lift up these prayer concerns of ours to you, O Lord, in this moment of silence. Lord, in your mercy.
Okay.
It is in your hands, O Lord, that we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Holy is the Lord.
Holy is the Lord.
It was in the night in which he was betrayed that our Lord took bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and he gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You can get out your looking through packets. This is the body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep in his grace.
Amen.
Before we end, I want to say thank you to these two for here. Mm-hmm. You want to give a round of applause? Yes. So he's a Scott guy. He's really good at this league. Well, in a former life, he was a pastor. So
just straight like that. Yeah, it seems like it.
Yeah. Just so you know, so thank you guys for that. Receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you in favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
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 You got a song?
We got a song.
All right.
Can we stand?
With grace and mercy, send.